What do you think is the best thing of being a rock star?
Playing for a lot of people. Mm-hmm. You know, the idea that you get out there every night and there's 10 or 20,000 people to play for. It's a nice feeling.
And what do you think is the image people have of you?
Probably that of a singer in a rock and roll band that likes to have a lot of fun.
Okay, and but you are a sex symbol? I mean, are you?
I don't consider myself a sex symbol. I haven't even taken a shower today. You know?
And what about the girls?
How sexy is that? God bless the women, you know. I mean, I like that a lot of girls come and see us play. I think it's wonderful.
I read that you were working as a waiter, as a cleaning staff, or something. Tell me about this period.
Well, I mean, everybody has to have jobs, you know. I mean, you don't make money doing this for quite a while. And I was a busboy. I worked in an auto body shop. I worked in a shoe store. I worked selling newspapers. I did whatever I had to make a couple of bucks while I was playing. And this was always my first love.
Your childhood, what was it like?
It was just an average American childhood growing up. Where I grew up was very similar to that of Pittsburgh, you know. Not as big, but certainly as workmen, a blue-collar neighborhood kind of growing up.
And was your relationship with your parents good?
Yeah, it was pretty good.
What were your main problems as a teenager that you feel like, you know, I'm very...
Just the same things that everyone else feels, you know what I mean? What am I here for? It's, you know, it's useless. I don't have anything to look forward to. You know, how am I going to get out of this town? And, you know, the usual things that every kid
feeling does. Lost.
Well, lust was, you know, that came too later. Sure.
Have you ever been in therapy?
No.
Trying hard to capture the moment. This morning I don't know. 'Cause a bottle of vodka still lies in my head, and some blonde gave me nightmares. Think that you're still in my bed. As I dream about movies that won't make of me when I'm dead.
When did you start composing? When did you feel that you could do it?
I was about 18, I guess, when I first started. I joined an original band the first time.
And you sat at the piano and you start...
And guitar, and you know, it wasn't until later that I played piano, but guitar really.
But did you read poetry?
Not in order to learn how to write. I think writing came first from listening to other records. And then it went into literature after, many years after.
And always about love, since the beginning, I mean...
I mean, that's initially what you write about.
Yeah.
And then it grows from there.
At the beginning you felt your romantic side very strong?
I think when you're that young, there's not much else to write about. You're just discovering love for the first time. You're discovering a lot of things about... girls and music and life and, you know, what it's like to not be a little kid anymore. I've been in love a couple of times. Yeah, absolutely. It's a wonderful feeling.
What kind of guy you were? He looks too cold. Are you that cold?
I got a cold.
Okay, but you are a cold guy. I mean, you know, very in control of yourself.
I'm not the guy with the lampshade on his head at the party, but I was always a bit of a loner, you know. Yeah, the kinds of bands I played in were not the ones that were playing the music that everyone always listened to, and you know. The kids I hung around in school were not the the athletes or the, you know, the ones that got all the attention. Mm-hmm. So I was pretty much a loner.
Oh, really? Mm-hmm. And the guy who loved a girl from distance, from far?
Yeah, right. Mm-hmm.
That kind of
right.
guy.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, I see. Have you ever feel rejected?
Sure, all the time. It's part of living.
When did you find out that you were a handsome guy?
I don't know. I don't worry about that kind of stuff. To me, it's...
You are not vain.
I hope not.
No?
I would have taken a shower if I was...
Well, vain, but you look pretty good, I think. Huh? Why did you cut your hair?
It was simply a girl that I know who cut hair for a living asked if she could cut it, and I said, well, yeah, sure, it'll grow back, and I liked it.
So you were not the kind of person who take care of yourself?
I do. I mean, I'm sitting here drinking water, because I've got a cold, but
mm-hmm.
I'm not, in the mirror and, facelifts and dyeing my hair and, that kind of,
mm-hmm.
it's not my...
Mainly because you don't need it, maybe. When you discover sex?
I was very young.
Very young?
Yeah, I was probably 12 or 13, first time.
The first time? Do you remember it?
Yeah, very well.
Was something very nice?
No, I didn't like it at all. I didn't know what the big deal was.
Oh, really? Were you afraid? I mean.
Yeah, probably.
Mm. Shy?
I did it at that age. I wasn't too shy, no.
Are you shy now?
Mm-hmm. No.
Mm-mm. No. You are a kind of, but you're not kind of aggressive, are you?
Mm-mm.
What kind of husband are you?
I don't know. I'm all right, I guess. I come home once in a while. I don't make too much of a mess. I'm not there too often.
Oh, no?
Uh-uh.
Oh, so she doesn't see you so often?
Well, I don't go home that often. I'm usually out here on the road somewhere.
Is your wife jealous?
No.
No? And are you faithful?
Yep.
What kind of woman do you like?
One with a heartbeat.
A what?
Right over your head. That's okay.
What? What?
I like women. All kinds. Big, tall, short, fat, skinny. I love women.
This physically, you mean? And what about inside? What kind of temper?
I don't know. Even tempered would be
without
preferable.
Temper.
Yeah.
You like sweet girls like geishas or strong women? What kind of relationship do you have with women?
Not one like you, because you would be a tough cookie.
Oh, for sure. I think you are
high
tough coffee. But you
would be high maintenance.
Oh,
I could see
yeah,
that.
Yeah, I can see you too. You came here and said no, yes, no.
I'd have to spend a lot of money to keep a girl like you happy.
Are you kidding? I'm not happy
I
with money.
You're not?
No, not at all. I have money enough. I don't need money of any man.
Oh, good.
No man. Of course not. I do my own career.
You're a very strong woman.
I'll be sure of this. You can be sure. So. And what?
You want to arm wrestle? You know what that is?
Let's try.
You know how to thumb wrestle? Give me your hand. You know how to thumb wrestle? Mm. You know what this is? Right, watch my thumb.
So?
And you go, one, do this. One, and go like this. One, two, three. And then the object is to get the other person's thumb down like that.
Uh-huh.
And that'll show how strong you are.
Let's do this one.
Like I said, high maintenance this one. High maintenance.
Long time no see, my friends. How have you been? Okay. Oh, the way I look at it, Friday night is finally here. There ain't nobody gotta go to school tomorrow. Ain't nobody gotta get up and go to work. And if you do, you tell them that I said it's okay for you to stay in bed, baby. Shout through the heart. Hey, yo. We'll be right back.
How do you feel?
I feel like the kids got their money's worth.
Oh, really?
I feel that I gave them everything I could give them, and then some. And that's what this is all about.
A good performance. How do you calm down after the excitement of the show?
It takes a while. It takes a couple of hours. You know, what we would usually do is get on the plane now and travel late at night.
Oh, really? Because during the night?
Yeah, because we have our own plane.
Uh-huh.
And it gives you an hour, usually about an hour flight every day. But it gives you an hour to just be with the band, talk about the show, eat something good, have a drink, and then you're ready to go to bed. Then you wind down. By the time you get to the plane, fly for an hour, drive to the hotel, get in your room, that's 2 hours. And then you're ready.
Do you feel always satisfied with your performance?
No. Definitely not. Tonight wasn't an A show to me. It was okay. It was good.
It was great?
To me, it wasn't great.
Why not?
I was given as much as I had to give, but sometimes it felt that I didn't have enough. I wanted to give even more. And I would reach, and there was nothing in the gas tank anymore.
How do you re-energize yourself?
Not the right way. Not by doing anything I should do.
For instance?
I should drink water, go to bed at night, eat a good meal once in a while.
Mm.
Me, bottle of wine, cheeseburger, go to bed.
Junk food?
Can't help it.
When something goes wrong in a show, you know, what is your first reaction?
Oh, you get that.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to kill everybody look.
Who you blame?
The monitor man. The guy that makes my speakers sound good.
He's the one.
Yeah, but it's never his fault, but that's who I blame. I just look at him, you know, and he just goes like, you know, like that. And if I have good monitors, if I hear well, then everything's great.
Have a side a little bit outsider that you want to keep?
Yeah. If I was feeling just a little bit better tonight, there's a great bar here that I usually go and play after we play the arena.
Mm-hmm.
But I know because tomorrow's another, you know, big show, I got to go back to the hotel tonight.
Before start a show, do you have any kind of things that you usually do, kind of, you know?
We put on some good loud music, something to get you in the mood. I warm up a bit, you know, go and yell in the bathroom or something.
Are you superstitious?
Yes, I wear the same stuff a lot, yes.
How do you deal with criticism?
Well, if it's constructive, if somebody has something constructive to say, if they said, you know, listen, I didn't think that you put enough energy into that rendition of the song, I'll read the review and go, yeah, okay, I get it. But if somebody comes here and goes, Bon Jovi, I hate it, that's not fair. Come and see what the 15,000 people out there tonight saw, you know, that kind of thing.
What is the worst thing that you don't like that you know, I don't like people saying this to me.
I don't pay that much attention to it to worry about it. You know, I'm not that concerned with the criticisms because the great satisfaction that I've had is 10 years so far and still going. Mm-hmm. You know, people were dying to say Bon Jovi's not going to happen anymore. You know, Keep the Faith isn't going to be successful. And it's doing very well.
Uh-huh.
It's doing very well. And some places better than others, of course. But the funny thing is they went, oh, you know, you can't go out and tour. 15,000 kids showed up here tonight. You know, I guess we can, you
mm-hmm.
know. And it's been like that every night, and it's going great. And so we're proving all those people wrong. And you know what the funny thing is that's sort of spooking me is we get great reviews now, and I'm not used to it. You know, I got to laugh when the New York Times writes, this is a great rock and roll show. You go,
and what has changed?
I just think that I have to laugh because I go, you know what? They figured out that I can take a punch.
Mm.
And I just keep coming back. And then you hit me, and then I come back. And then they finally said, we've hit them long enough. Let them stand up.
Keep your faith?
Mm-hmm.
What kind of faith?
I had to go find it again. After the Blaze of Glory record, it was five albums in a row, four tours in a row. Like, the Blaze record was like withdrawals to me. It was a case of winding down, getting away from 1983 till 90, I lived on the road.
Uh-huh.
The only time I'd get some sleep would be in a dressing room like this. The only time I'd eat, like I said, was on the plane. You lived like this. This is it. And if you're sick, too bad. You got to go to work. And if you're, you know, you miss home, too bad. You're going to be in London for Christmas. I finally said, enough. And then couldn't just quit cold turkey. So mm-hmm. I did the Blaze of Glory record. And then I said, no tour. But I went on the road with a guy named Southside Johnny, who I told you about, who's just like plays like bars. And I just was the guitar player, stood in the back, but I got to go on the road again. Went out for a month, and step by step, walked away from this. Because I had to figure out if I still loved what I used to love. Or if I even still liked what I used to love, which was getting out there and singing, writing songs, making people happy. Because for a long time, I didn't love it. You know, I wanted nothing less.
Uh-huh.
You know, I didn't want to get out there. I didn't want to write a record. I didn't want to say anything. I got disillusioned with a lot of what was going on out there. And then I wrote songs.
Why this kind of reaction? Why?
It became a machine.
Oh, I see.
It became a machine.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we were playing places, this place in particular. We sold this joint out three or four nights in a row. And the roof here opens up. Nobody knows that. Because nobody can ever even do it. No one mm-hmm. can sell enough tickets to pay to open the roof up. Just be on a whim. That's the kind of stuff I would do. Open the roof. You know, boom. And
mm-hmm.
it would happen.
Mm-hmm.
Another number one record. Boom. Sold out. Boom. Four, five nights anywhere. Boom.
Power.
Boom, boom.
You feel the power.
Didn't feel the power, but more importantly, didn't enjoy the power. Went through it with blinders on. Every time that I wanted to like take a step back, you looked at it and go, maybe it's going to be over tomorrow.
Mm.
I better not admit that I'm in, you know, that we're happening here.
Mm-hmm.
And then when I finally realized, and it took time, you know, you gotta grow up and do it, is that, you know, look, it ain't about that. When we came to Brazil for the first time,
How was it?
The audiences were great. We were ridiculously burned out. We had no idea what we were doing.
Why?
Too many years on the road without getting off the road.
Mm-hmm.
We were playing the Hollywood Rock and all that kind of stuff. You know, when we played, I think the festivals were on weekends. So you were supposed to stay and enjoy the sun in Rio for a week. You know what I did? Played the show, got on a plane back to New York, came down the next weekend. I couldn't even stand to sit there in the sun. I was just like a basket case. All I did was reach for a bottle every day, drink it, get hungover, wake up the next day, play the
show. Bottle of what? Whiskey?
Whatever. Uh-huh. That's where it was, you know? Uh-huh. I mean, because you just had to forget about the other 22 hours of the day. Mm-hmm. I remember playing in the Hollywood Festival and Alec falling down on stage a couple times. Mm-hmm. Just so burned, so exhausted, so high, he had to go and dry out, you know? Tico had to go and dry out. We all had to go and dry out. Uh-huh. We just needed to get away from this.
Yeah.
And to see if we still liked what we used to love.
Light a candle, blow the world away. Table for two on a TV tray. It ain't fancy, baby, that's okay. All the time, all the way. Everybody needs somebody. Everybody needs somebody.
Do you believe in God?
Yeah.
Are you a kind of guy who prays?
Yeah.
Yeah. And do you go to church?
No, I think church is right here. I think church is everywhere, anywhere you want it to be. Mm-hmm. I don't think that you have to go to a to a place and, you know, and pay money and all that kind of stuff to talk to God.
I heard that you meet every city that you go, you meet sick people and you talk to
them. That's what I was doing just now, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Tell me about this. What moves you to do this?
Being as lucky as I've been, being as blessed as I've been, and when I was a kid, what would have been cooler than your favorite rock and roll star calling you up on the phone one day? Mm-hmm. You know, just saying, "How are you?" Imagine that. Let alone if you're sick or something. It's a miracle how sometimes people get happy, and they get up out of their hospital bed because they get excited. You know, so if I can do that, it takes 15 minutes of my time.
Mm-hmm.
But it makes somebody's day, you know?
Sure.
It's pretty cool. I'm not a tough guy. I'm just introverted. I'm like I was saying, I'm not the life of the party. I'm not the guy that comes in the room and goes, "I'm here," and I don't make my hair fancy to come in here and wear, you know, beautiful sport jackets. And it's not my thing.
I understand.
I mean? To me, it's if I have nothing to say, I don't say it. You know, I just don't speak out because I can't. I'd rather, you know, take it in, learn. Because just because I do what I do doesn't mean that I'm any better or smarter or anything else than anybody else.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I understand. But are you afraid of being a sensitive guy?
No. Mm-mm. No, I'm completely at ease with not worrying about what's fashionable. Throwing TVs out windows. I did all that shit, you know what I mean? I did all the goofy things that these guys do now and throw temper tantrums and go on stage 3 hours late and somebody threw TVs in Brazil out the window at reporters. And you know, I would never take a chance of hurting, maybe killing somebody who came there to see me. How ridiculous. How fuck? Yeah, you know, it's
because there is something in the rock, mainly in rock and roll. There is a kind of mask, you know. There is a kind of pose.
What made us who we are is that we let the people into what it is. When I went to Russia, we played at a place called the Lenin Stadium for the Moscow Music Peace Festival. And we were this big headliner in Russia. And being an American, you grow up being told that the Russians are the bad guys and our Olympic team didn't go to the Olympics there and, you know, all this stuff. And then here's this guy in a garage band in New Jersey playing this stadium for 2 days. But the magic that we've always had, even with Spanish, you know, you can make out a couple English words and you know, I can pick up a few Spanish words. Russian is very different. Now, a lot of what I do is talk to the audience.
Mm-hmm.
And I get my points across with lyrics. Now, I'm in Russia the first night. In a place where there's no MTV, where there's no rock and roll radio, where there's no record stores to go buy records. And I don't realize until I'm on stage that I've been reduced to being in a bar band again. Nobody knows my records. So we play and didn't get a great response. I don't know, you know, it was okay. And I says, I know what it is. They didn't get to touch us. That's the magic of what this is about, that it's the same thing. We have the image of being this garage band, the guys next door.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, for a while, you go, Christ, maybe we're supposed to be bad boys. Maybe that'll sell records. Maybe we're supposed to be drug addicts. Maybe that'll sell records, you know? What I found is be yourself.
You want the truth.
And nothing but the truth.
Mm-hmm.
And if people like you for it.
You don't want to pretend. You don't want to fake something. You.
That's all I can do.
And it's hard to find out the truth in the middle of so many stuff.
That's why we walked away. You know, that's why I was able to walk away and, more importantly, was able to survive it.
You stopped your band during for 2 years. And this was the reason.
Mm-hmm.
And but you almost split also. Why?
We didn't split. I think that was the press, especially in England, that started that rumor. Because there wasn't a lot of good dirt to write about us.
Mm-hmm.
There wasn't heroin addiction. There wasn't child abuse. There, you know, I mean, we all got along. But when we were playing in places like the Hollywood Rock Festival, which was very exciting for us, our first time in Brazil and South America, and you got, like, your bass player falling down because he can't even stand up anymore, somebody somewhere should have told us, you guys are tired. Go home. You know, you're cheating yourselves. And we would try. We would try to put on a great show every night. And I think the shows didn't suffer. I think the shows were great.
But why you didn't stop?
Because the machine was telling us to go. The managers, the agents, the lawyers, everybody. We did 3 tours of Europe on that album.
Mm-hmm.
So many shows. And then they said, go to South America. We said, well, we've never been there. We better go. And then, you know, I said, okay. And then I told the band. The band said, okay. And we went. And then from there, they said, you know, you've never been to Mexico. There's a few stadiums down there. You should go and play. Okay, we should go to Mexico. Man, by the time we were in Mexico, I mean, I couldn't even shave anymore. I had a full beard. I mean, I was looking more like Jim Morrison than
yeah,
John Bon Jovi.
I know.
I was like, whew, big black circles. But nobody, and I don't think it's a slap for me to say it, but unless you are not even working for the band, but a member of the band, you don't know how tired you are, and everybody's just trying to do their best to get you to do more work, to help you to do achieve what you want to achieve, but you're pushing and you're pushing.
I know exactly what you mean.
And you're dying, and nobody does, you know, nobody sees it, so no one stops it.
What is your relationship with your partners like?
The band is good. I think it's one of mutual respect and love, and I think that it's important, you know, when you see someone like a Richards, again, I keep using him as an example, because there are always going to be better players than each one of the Rolling Stones. Mm-hmm. But the Rolling Stones are a great band.
Yeah, but they fought a lot. I mean,
yeah, they fight a lot.
You know,
we don't fight a lot, but the magic of playing with a band, as opposed to, we did a song called Runaway Tonight. I wrote that song 11 years ago. I honestly haven't played it in 5 years. Walked out tonight and said, here's the set list. And the guys went, holy Christ, okay, amen. And that's all I have to do. Now, mm-hmm. if that was Jeff Beck, Elton John, all the guys I played with, they'd be looking at me going, oh no, we can't do that. You know, it's mm-hmm. not what we're doing here. Richie's as sick as he can possibly be, but he put out tonight with every ounce of energy that he had. That's the kind of thing when you got a band.
And when you compose together, is easy
to create
together?
It is easy to create together because we're on the same wavelength, you know?
How do you do?
Usually a title, sometimes a riff. You come in and
you work by yourself?
Well, no. We start from scratch if we're working together.
Mm-hmm.
And for the most part.
Keep the faith, keep the faith. Lord, we've got to keep the faith. Tell me, baby, when I hurt you, do you keep it all inside? Do you tell me?
Do you write about yourself?
Sometimes, More now than
your
ever
feelings,
before.
Feelings, you mean it?
More now than ever before. What I did in the past sometimes was hid behind characters. Billy the Kid for Blaze of Glory, or Tommy and Gina and Living on a Prayer, and the image of cowboys on, you know, Wanted Dead or Alive. Mm-hmm. But now
you like this image.
I do, because in essence that's what we were. That's what we are.
You feel like that.
Well,
like
you come into a town, you ride in, you don't know anything, you don't know anyone, you make your bed for the night and you leave.
Uh-huh.
You know, so it in a way paralleled that. It paralleled life in the circus or a carnival. And, and something a lot less glamorous, you're like a traveling salesman.
Yeah, and like a cowboy in 91, you did a big cross, a trip crossing America.
Yeah.
In motorcycle. What was your image during the... about?
I needed to go away from everything that I had known and go and find myself and what it was that I loved about this and see if I even liked it anymore. But I was, like I said, disillusioned. I had made all the money I ever thought I would. I had all the number one records more than I ever thought I would. You know, all these stadiums in places where my heroes never dreamt about going. And it was bigger than big. And yet, you know, you're going, it's not worth it. It's not worth being feeling like that. Spending Christmases in hotel rooms and Thanksgivings in foreign countries, and it wasn't worth it.
In the 60s, the bands have a position of rebellion against the establishment. Do you think, what is the rock and roll against nowadays? He's fighting against something?
I think
something?
It's angry. I think rock and roll right now is very angry.
Does it fight against something?
I think it's fighting the establishment as much or more than ever. I mean, look at Pearl Jam writing songs like Jeremy, who blew, you know, Jeremy blew his head off in class today, and real honest-to-goodness things. I mean, a kid walked into a classroom in Los Angeles last week and killed somebody.
Mm-hmm.
Wow. What a scary thought. I think kids are very angry. They're very frustrated in what's going on out there. I think there's every bit the anger. There's more anger than there was in the 60s.
But it's more romantic also.
Oh, I don't think so.
I saw your audience. You know, they are in awe with you.
Our audience is a very positive one because I'm an optimist. I see the glasses half full instead of half empty. I've always believed in the positive. I think stating the obvious negative, any one of us can see that. When you come in the arena, I want you to forget it for a couple hours. And maybe if you leave here with a smile on your face because there was keep the faith, because there was I believe, because there was something like that, you walk out and maybe you'll smile at the cab driver. Maybe the cab driver won't honk his horn at somebody. Maybe that guy won't shoot somebody else in the fast lane, you know. So you can start it, you know, if you want to, you know, from a whisper.
Have you ever taken drugs?
Sure.
What kind?
I experimented. I tried pot and cocaine, and you know.
Are you still?
Never. No, I haven't done it in so many years.
What are your plans now?
I want to do this for a year, and I want to be able to give 110% for a year. I'm going to take some breaks during the year, and I want everybody to see the best I got to give them. And then I want to do some experimenting, maybe some movies or
as an
soundtracks.
Actor?
Yeah, I'll do a movie.
Okay. So, cowboy, thank you very much
for this interview.
So full of moments.
There you go.
Different moments.
Jaman Zon Produções e Rede Manchete apresentaram Bruna Lombardi em Gente de Expressão.
Um oferecimento Varig, acima de tudo você.